Hi everyone, welcome to my channel English Literature 101. The topic for today is The Old Clock Shop. It is prescribed in CBSE for class 6 in the book named A Pact with the Sun. So without any further delay, let's begin with the story. The Old Clock Shop. Christmas Eve had arrived. As last minute shoppers were going home, a thick white sheet of snow lay over Salt Lake City, USA. Yet the lights were still burning in the old clock shop as Ray, its old deaf owner, worked on a clock he had sold that day. So, in the first paragraph itself, we find that the writer provided us with minute details about the story. What are these details? Let's find out. Firstly, the writer talks about the time or the day the story happens, and the day is Christmas Eve, or we can say Christmas evening. Secondly, the place where the story takes place, that is Salt Lake City, USA. Thirdly, the writer talks about the setting or background of the story, that is, it is basically a marketplace, and as it is Christmas, it's cold and snowy outside. Everything is covered with snow. And what else we find? We get the name of one of our characters. His name is Ray. Not only the name, but we also come to know two things about him. First, he is the owner of an old clock shop. Second, he is old and deaf. So just see that the writer has framed the story so very well. So basically, it was a Christmas evening in Salt Lake City, USA. The marketplace was clearing off, that is, all people were going home. But somewhere far away, light was still on in an old clock shop, whose owner was Ray, who was old and deaf, and he was working over a sold clock. Having finished his work, Ray stood up and was on his way to the back room, when a cold rush of air from the front door hit the back of his neck. So after finishing his work, when Ray got up and was about to go to the back room, a cold wave of air touched his neck from the front door. He turned to meet a last minute shopper, but his old wise eyes told him that this was not a shopper. He saw two men, one in his 20s, the other closer to 50. The younger man remained at the door. The older man approached the counter with no sign of friendliness in his eyes. Ray was able to hide his growing fear as he slowly pushed a notepad and a pencil across the counter. So when cold wind hit Ray from the front door, he looked back and saw a customer who came to his shop. But as Ray was wise and experienced, he found something fishy. He felt that the person who came in did not come to buy anything. There were two men. One was young, around 20s, and the other middle-aged, that is about 50s. The younger man stayed outside while the middle-aged man came to Ray's counter. Seeing them, Ray was scared. But hiding his fear, he slowly pushed a notepad and pencil towards him. He smiled at the unfriendly face, then pointed to his ears and shook his head from side to side. A quick look of surprise changed the man's face as he studied the notepad, then turned and said something to his friend. Amidst such fear, Ray smiled, looking at the man, and gave his notepad, in which he had written something. And in gestures, or we can say hand movement, Ray pointed to his ears and shaked his head, signifying that he is deaf. On seeing the thing that was written on the notepad, there was a sudden change on the man's face, and he turned to his friend and said something. Ray used the chance to look closely at the man, paying attention to the shape of a gun and a restless hand in the man's right coat pocket. Anger boiled within him, but it was kept down by an inner voice that said, "Be still." He wrote on the notepad, "May I help you?" For the first time, the older man looked directly at Ray and smiled, a cruel, mocking smile. They both understood why he was there, why his friend remained at the door. They looked like men who were down on their luck and were now ready to try something they would later be sorry about. So when the man was talking to his friend, Ray got some time to examine the man closely. The first thing Ray observed was a gun and its shape, and secondly, his hand movement in his coat's right pocket. Ray, on seeing it, was angry, but as he was wise, he understood the need to stay calm, cool, and quiet at that moment. He asked the man, writing on notepad, that how could he help him. On reading it, the man looked at Ray directly and gave a cruel smile. Ray somehow understood that why the two men came, or why one man stood at the door. Ray felt that something might happen which they could repent later. The clock ticked on. Ray calmly wrote another message. "Have you come to pick up a clock or watch?" Then he pointed to the loan board filled with hanging clocks and pocket watches. He was not a pawnbroker, but at the same time couldn't say no to the needy people who placed their old watches or clocks before him for anything they could get. He loaned more than he should. They would be there when the owners wanted them back, at the same price he had paid with no interest. So the clocks ticked on. This line can have various meanings. First, it was too late. Second, they were there for too long. Third, Ray's heart was beating too fast because of such situation. Ray then quietly asked them another question, writing a message, saying that if they had come to his shop to take a clock or watch. Then he pointed to a board, which is a loan board. In that board, it was filled with hanging clocks and pocket watches of those whom Ray gave some money as loan in exchange of those watches or clocks. Ray did this not because he needed interest, but in order to help needy people, because he was very kind-hearted. But Ray knew that those men or his visitors were not in need of watches, but money. Then the older man seemed to feel a little easier, took out his hand from his pocket and quickly looked at the watch on his wrist. "How much will you give me for this?" the man wrote. On reading the note from Ray, the older man felt easy. He looked at his watch on his wrist and asked Ray that what price would he offer him for his wristwatch. Ray noticed a little shame in the gray eyes looking at him. The watch was nothing special and yet had great powers. It was something to exchange, a way out of a bad situation. Knowing that great need had brought the man to his shop in the first place, Ray asked, "How much do you need for it?" The reply came back on the notepad, "Whatever it's worth." So as the conversation proceeded, Ray could notice a little shame in the eyes of the man. The wristwatch which the man showed Ray was nothing special, yet it had great powers. Why? Because it was a way out from a bad situation. That is, it can save Ray from being robbed by two men. But Ray knew that dire need had brought the man to his shop and helplessness had put him into such a bad act of robbery. So Ray asked, "How much do you need for the watch?" And a reply came in the notepad from the man saying, "Whatever it's worth." That is, the man demanded Ray to pay whatever was the worth of the watch. Ray reached into his cash box, pulled out a $50 note and passed it into the man's hand. As they shook hands, Ray looked into the man's eye. They seemed to say, "Thank you." They both knew the watch wasn't worth that much. Before turning to leave, the man wrote, "I will be back to pick it up as soon as I can. Merry Christmas." Ray then went to his cash box, took out $50 note and gave it to the man. This made the man very happy. The man expressed his gratitude, though both of them knew that the watch was not of that high price, but still the man thanked him, and before leaving Ray's shop, the man wished him Merry Christmas and assured him that he would come back again to take his watch. The little story ended on the half hour, with the clock striking altogether. The timepieces, which had been looking on silently all the while, rang out the time with such feeling that even Ray thought he could hear them. Their sweet musical message was filled with hope. The timeless message of peace on earth, goodwill towards all, was felt by the three men who stood in the old clock shop. The writer here says that finally the story comes to an end and the bell strikes everywhere, that is, it's Christmas, which spreads the message of hope and peace. The writer says that the bad time or the bad situation had passed and now everywhere there is peace. The music that the bells produce are so sweet and refreshing and impactful that even Ray, who was deaf, could feel it. A message of goodwill and peace was felt everywhere as the clock chimes Merry Christmas. So guys, that's all for today's video, and I hope you all have understood the chapter well. If you have any queries regarding the chapter, do let me know in the comment section below. And please don't forget to like and subscribe my channel. Thank you.